Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. My name is Bilal Abdul Karim for OGN. And most people know by now that Tokia Tak Sharif, also known as Abu Hussam al-Britani, was arrested on June 22nd by the group known as Hayat Tahrir Sham here in the free territories of Syria, in the small town of Atma, to be exact. Up until now, there's been no official charge from Hayat Tahrir Sham regarding the reason for his arrest. Recently, there was a visit of Tokia Sharif while he is in prison, and one of the people that visited him was my guest, which is next to me right now, and he is Abdullah Jabbar, and he's the nephew of Tokia Tak Sharif. And I want to say to you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
When you went to go and visit your uncle, what did you see?
So we went into a small room. Obviously, this is not a prison, so this is not somewhere that they're holding him. And first off, obviously, I tried to give him salam. But as I went to go for his hand, I actually put my hand around his wrist. So subhanAllah, straight off the bat, I could tell that he has lost weight because my whole hand actually went around his wrist. And obviously, I've been training with my uncle. This is a person that I've trained with a lot and someone that I wanted to be like. He's very big, he's very hench. And to put my hand around his wrist was a bit crazy. SubhanAllah, even his t-shirt was hanging off of him. So he had lost a lot of weight. We were in the room. Obviously, there was about eight people in and around the room. So there was guards outside and there was a member from here, Tahrir Sham, in the room, while me and my auntie were there to see him.
Mm-hmm. So inside of the room, it's you, your aunt, meaning his wife, Tokia, and one member of Hayat Tahrir Sham. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. Did that person say anything? Was he a part of it, or was he basically hanging back, or what?
So the conversation started. Obviously, they were speaking about the situation with my uncle, and obviously, straight away, I saw that he was covering something on his head. So this is something that I realized straight away. Then, after itching it a little bit, we realized that he has a cut on his head. And being someone that has worked in the medicinal field for a little while, I could tell that, subhanAllah, this cut needs stitches, it's an open wound. So while they were speaking to him, they were speaking to him about the projects and about the money. They were saying to him that he's an untrustworthy person and that the funds he's getting, he's taking for himself. And he made a clear point. He said, listen, the money that I get for all of my projects go to the specific projects that are there, and everything is documented, everything is written down. So then they said something to him that it confused me a bit. They said that you haven't given us anything. Now, when I heard that, I was a bit confused. I was like, what do they mean? So my uncle said, what do you mean by I haven't given you anything? As I said, everything that comes goes for the project. These donations are for specific projects like the orphan camp, like the widow's camp. And I have to put it to the specific projects. So I have to use it for that. And it's all documented.
You mentioned that he had a cut. How did that cut happen? Exactly, what was that about?
So subhanAllah, when he was first taken, when he was first kidnapped, we were reassured that he was safe, he was fine, there was nothing wrong with him. And they told us this repeatedly. Until the fourth day, some of the neighbors from the area, because obviously he was kidnapped while looking at another house. So some of the neighbors from the area actually came to us and said, listen, there was some kind of fight that kicked off while he was kidnapped. So I myself went to the place where he was kidnapped from, and I looked at the floor and I could see that there's blood there. So I went and asked them myself. I said, listen, what is this blood? Who did it come off of? And they made some calls. Then they said to me, you know what? He was actually hit in the head three times with the back of the gun repeatedly. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. And they didn't tell us that at the start. So it was a bit confusing. Why are you holding information from us? We should have known that at the start. They said that obviously medics are supposed to see their prisoners as soon as they're being taken. But if the medic hasn't wrote a report on this, then it's a bit confusing to me.
When you were there and you were sitting, you were talking to him, did he request anything? Did he want anything? Ask for anything specific?
Now, the only thing that my uncle requested while we were there, and this is what he asked us to talk and say on his behalf, is that he hasn't seen a qadi. No one of Islamic
a qadi,
knowledge.
Just so people can understand, yeah. A qadi is a judge.
So no one that has Islamic knowledge, nobody that's someone that like a sheikh or a qadi, a judge that can come and see him and understand his points. Because he said clearly, he said, if a qadi was to come and see me right now, he would know I'm innocent and I can clarify with that with him.
So as far as you know, he hasn't seen a judge.
He hasn't seen a judge at all.
Hayat Sahri al-Sham has not given you anything in writing in terms of what his charges are. Is that correct?
No, nothing has been written down on his charges. Nothing in writing at all.
So when you heard them saying, well, you're not giving anything to us, I mean, what was your feeling when you heard that?
I was confused. One, that they're claiming that he is untrustworthy himself. Me working with my uncle all of these years, I've been here 8 years with him. I know my uncle doesn't take a wage. He doesn't take a penny out of the donation money. And he's made it very, very clear to me, anytime we go to a distribution, anytime we donate the money, he says that we have to find the families that are the most needy. So we double check every single family that we're giving to. So for you to be saying someone is untrustworthy and then at the same time saying, listen, why are you not giving me anything? It's a bit confusing, and to me it was a contradiction.
What do you think that people should know about this case that's taking place now that they don't know? What would you like for them to know?
Obviously, I would say firstly, it's not as it seems. Even when we went to this meeting, it was set up really nice. They made it look like it's really nice. They had stuff there for him. They gave him drinks, water. But the reality is, that's not true. It's a facade. That's how they made it look for us. He was in an office where it's clearly, this is not the place that they're holding him. Even he was told to leave before us, so definitely we knew for sure that this wasn't where they're holding him and this is not the treatment he's getting. And number two, my uncle is a big campaigner for prisoners' rights, and he's been talking about it in Syria for a long time. So subhanAllah, if it wasn't him, and this is what I was thinking while I was there as well, if this guy wasn't my uncle, if he wasn't the big known name that he is, would it just be a guy that's gone and no one knows anything about him?
Are you afraid for your safety or afraid in any way because you're making the statements and the comments that you're making now?
No, I'm not afraid for my safety. Obviously, we've given them time. They've asked us to lay off the social media. Obviously, they know that I'm a big face and a big
talker.
They
asked you to lay off
the social media. Yeah, we were told to lay off social media. Don't say nothing. It will help his case. But I'm sorry, we're 2 weeks into this now and we haven't heard nothing. We still don't know where he's being held. We still don't know what's going on. Nothing has been written down. Nothing has been told to us. So them saying to me, don't say anything, is not really helping the situation. So I feel like me talking will help, inshallah, and that's why I'm doing it. But in terms of my family, of course, they're the ones that are worried for my safety, because if this can happen to him, and subhanAllah, the maddest thing is, an official from HTS actually told me that they believe he's innocent. So if this can happen to an innocent man, why can it not happen to me?
All right. I want to thank you for your time, to clear up some of these matters. My name is Bilal Abdul Karim, and we've been sitting talking to Abdullah Jabbar, who is the nephew of Tawqiya Talk Sharif, also known as Abu Hussam al-Britani. Jazakum Allah khaira. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.